Okay. Yeah, so in the previous class, we were discussing the contraction mapping theorem and how it applies to a Lagrangian method. And the final thing that we were not able to resolve in the previous class is if real part of lambda I of B was positive, then there exist alpha such that, no, not alpha, eta greater than 0 such that rho of I minus alpha B is less than 1. And I thought about it, and I figured the following value for eta. Eta has to be less than min over all I to real part of lambda I of B over absolute value of lambda I of B square. So if this holds, then rho of I minus alpha, well, no, this should be eta. I minus eta B is less than 1. Okay, so this is the range of eta for which the spectral radius of this matrix is going to be less than 1. And let's try to prove this result. Not a very complicated result, but since somebody asked me this question, I thought I'll just prove it in the class, just to show how it can be done. So lambda I of I minus eta B is equal to 1 minus eta lambda I of B. So let's assume lambda I of B is Ci plus J Di. J is negative 1. Oh, square root of negative 1. Okay. So this is 1 minus eta Ci minus J eta Di. Okay. So now I need to show that the spectral radius is less than 1, which means I need to take the absolute value of lambda I one minus eta Ci. Let me take the absolute value square because it's much easier to analyze this. So 1 minus eta Ci square plus eta square Di square. Ci. Okay, so this was the expression we had in the previous class, and now I need to show that for eta in this range, I'll have the spectral radius less than 1, or in other words, for every I, this square is going to be less than 1. So I need to show that this is less than 1. So this is equivalent to saying that eta minus 2 eta ci plus eta square ci square plus di square is less than 0, which is equivalent to saying that eta is less than 2 ci over ci square plus di square. Okay, so now I pick the minimum over all possible I here, and so if that is the situation, then this sum is going to be less than 1 for all I. Okay. Yeah.
Where is the part where did you find or did you get the maximum eigenvalue?
So if all eigenvalues are strictly less than 1, then the maximum eigenvalue will also be less than 1. Right?
Yes.
Yeah. That's what I'm using. Any other question? The other thing to note is that if real part of lambda ib was not positive, there is no way I could have gotten this expression. Okay? So it was important for real part of eigenvalue of B to be strictly positive, because only then eta could be strictly positive. Otherwise, no, it cannot be done. Okay, this is also the reason why I'm doing this in class, is because I want to show you how you can get bounds on the step sizes based on the eigenvalues of the underlying operator in order to make sure that your gradient descent or whatever algorithm you're using would converge. So this is the reason why if you pick eta large, so if you pick eta, if you pick a value of eta that is larger than this value, this operator will not be a contraction operator along certain directions, and along those directions your algorithm will escape to infinity. Okay? So this is your space, and no matter, so if you pick your value of eta large, larger than this value, you will have one direction, let's say this direction, and if you pick an initial condition x naught here, your algorithm will converge along all other directions but diverge along this direction. So you will see your algorithm escaping to infinity. If you pick x naught here, you will see your algorithm escaping to infinity in the other direction. Okay? So that's the reason why your step size has to be sufficiently small in order to make sure that your overall map is a contraction. If your map is a contraction, then your algorithm would converge. Okay. The other important thing to note is, how many of you have taken 3551, feedback control systems, and you have learned about Bode plot? Okay, so in Bode plot, under some conditions, if you remember, for certain values of gain k, your system would become unstable, right? And the reason is that your continuous time map would not be a contraction if your gain was too high. Okay? So this contraction operator appears again and again, but you just wouldn't know that there is some contraction happening in the underlying space. So if you have taken 3551, you have been exposed to the contraction operator, and the fact that your gain k has to be sufficiently small in order for your system to be stable, And under some conditions, if your gain is too large, your system becomes unstable. That's exactly because of the same reason why your algorithms may diverge if your gain k, or not gain k, if your step size eta is too large. Okay? Same reasoning. There's no difference in reasoning. Underlying math is the same. It's just that the language is very different because one is using the language of feedback control systems. And here we are using the language of optimization. If you go to machine learning community, this is known as learning rate. So then they will say if the learning rate is too large, your system, your algorithm will not converge. So there again, the language is different, but the underlying concept is exactly same as this concept of contraction mapping. Yeah.
Why do we use the spectral gradient as opposed to like a determinant?
Determinant?
Like the absolute value of the determinant.
Yeah, good point. So do you know what a determinant implies for a matrix? For a square matrix? Yes. Right. So that's exactly right. So determinant of a matrix is the volume of the parallel pipe. So this is a three-dimensional space. You have a matrix A1, A2, A3. You draw A1, A2, A3. Complete a How do I make a parallelepiped? Okay, this is a parallelepiped. Okay, this looks like a parallelepiped, so it is a parallelepiped. Okay, so this the volume of this is exactly equal to the absolute value of determinant of this matrix. Okay, now what's the volume of a parallelepiped that has been compressed? So along one direction you have zero, along other direction it's not zero. So the volume is zero, but that doesn't mean that your vectors would be zero. Like your, if you keep multiplying this matrix again and again, then that will be zero.
Okay. So if I like flatten onto like a
hyperplane, right,
it can still expand.
Exactly. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. So that's why you need to look at contraction along all possible directions instead of contraction along this one direction, because you might escape to infinity along some direction, but not along other direction.
Okay.
The step size should be less than
right.
Some formula for minimum eigenvalue.
Yes.
So is there any algorithm which takes a matrix and outputs the minimum eigenvalue of that?
Well, I'm sure, yeah, there are. But unfortunately, in practice, you don't necessarily go through this step. You just pick eta according to your experience. Okay, so I'll pick eta equals to 10 raised to minus 5 because my friend sitting next to me has run this simulation last year and eta equals to 10 raised to minus 5 worked for him or her, right? So that's pretty much how you pick eta. Remember we had this step size selection rule where alpha k goes to 0, sum of alpha k equals to infinity and sum of alpha k square was less than infinity. So if you have this situation, eventually your alpha k would become very, very small, smaller than the minimum eigenvalue or whatever the formula here is, right? So that's why this algorithm is very, or this way of picking step size is very common, or at least was very common earlier, because you didn't have to fine tune the step size in order to make sure that it's a contraction, because eventually, initially, you may not be a contraction, but eventually you will become a contraction because your alpha k was converging to zero. Okay. But nowadays, people don't take alpha k going to zero because it leads to very slow convergence. So you just pick eta through trial and error. That is, in machine learning literature, it is known as hyperparameter tuning. I don't know if you've heard of this term before, but that's one of the hyperparameters of the machine learning algorithm. And you pick an appropriate value of eta to get a better convergence rate. And that is known as hyperparameter tuning. And there are algorithms for hyperparameter tuning. I don't know any algorithm, but I know that there are such algorithms that people are working on. I just don't remember it on top of my head. Any other question? Okay. Some of you might take, how many of you have taken nonlinear systems? I think 6, 7, 5, 1 or something. Not here. So even in nonlinear system, there is this concept of central manifold, unstable manifold, and stable manifold. Or if you have taken linear systems theory, there is uncontrollable subspace, controllable subspace. All of it relates to this idea of contraction. So in if you're taking 5, 5, 5, how many of you are taking 5, 5, 5, 1? So you know about uncontrollable subspace, right? So uncontrollable subspace is this subspace, the direction in which your algorithm diverges. Okay, so all of these concepts ties together when you take functional analysis, but until you take that course, everything is distinct. So you study these things in different classes, but eventually all of it sort of unifies into a single mathematical framework through contraction mapping theorem. So anyways, that's don't get me started on contraction mapping theorem. It's a very beautiful subject, but I can't spend an entire class on that. Okay. Today we are going to talk about a very important concept in optimization called duality. And this is a geometric concept. The idea is to understand the geometry of the optimization problem so that you can perhaps come up with better algorithms. Not better algorithms, but you can come up with some specialized algorithms for solving some special class of problems. So let me motivate it by a problem where I want to minimize a cost function f of x, where x lies in 0, 1 raised to n. Now think about, so scheduling problems typically are written in this fashion, where you have to schedule. So there are only two options, whether you schedule a machine to solve some problem or whether you not schedule a machine to solve that problem. Or it could be a gearbox situation in a car where you can only be at a specific gear at a specific time. You can't be at like five gears, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all five gears at the same time. You have to pick one of the discrete variables. Yeah. Yeah, this is a nonlinear programming.
Mixed but integer?
It's a mixed integer programming, yeah. Well, it's not, mixed integer programming will have an integer variable and a real variable, and the problem will be of this type. So that's mixed integer nonlinear programming. Okay. Okay, so now what I want you to think about is, if I give you a problem of this type, say in your final exam, this is a fictitious example because there are no final exams for this class. But let's say I give you a problem of this type in your final exam, and I ask you to solve it or come up with an algorithm to solve such a problem. How would you go about solving it? Sorry?
Try both? I don't know.
Try both? What do you mean both?
Well, I mean, you have x and 0 and 1.
Right. Oh, x and 0. So this is... not closed interval. This is just two points, 0 or 1. It's not closed interval 0, 1. OK, I probably didn't. I have to improve my braces capability. OK, so now this is.
Well, you can try, so there are two functions, right? And you have to pick between those two classes of functions,
where
x is 0 and
1. There are no two classes of functions, right? There is only. There are 2 raised to n, well, so the number of x is 2 raised to n, and of course y is a continuous variable, so yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so think about it, how you would go ahead and solve this problem. So this problem, so of course, these kind of problems are very common nowadays because of scheduling. So in scheduling, in automotive systems, in hybrid systems, where you have continuous as well as discrete variables, these kind of problems appear. Yeah?
When we're trying to find a convex function for it, so try to convert it to a convex function by, for example, considering the upper bound or lower bound, it might be a quasi-convex of which...
So you are saying that you will try and solve x in 0, 1 raised to n, and hope that you get an integer solution. But that's a hope. hope is a good thing. That was Shawshank Redemption's message, Wal.
I mean, if we can try to convert this function to a convex one, there is well-known algorithms like Tengelbach algorithm for solving this mixed integer nonlinear programming.
So all mixed integer nonlinear programming would depend on some concept of duality. So I'm motivating the concept of duality. So of course, there are algorithms that can solve this problem. Okay. So one idea is to expand the set. But the issue is that you can only hope that a solution which is integer valued would appear as the optimal solution to this problem. Now, if you want to solve the original problem without really convexifying it, then you cannot use gradient method because the gradient of f at discrete set of points is not defined. You have to have a concept of neighborhood in order to define a gradient. So somehow the existing methods that we have developed so far, which includes barrier method, penalty method, Lagrange